This documentary will follow the life and career of writer Tom Veitch, focusing on his early writings and interactions with the New York School poets. By looking closely at various works written by Veitch at different stages of his life, I will examine the effects that the New York School had on his writing, all the way up to his most notable works in the Star Wars extended universe. It should be noted that this is a scholarly research project created for Dr. Nicholas Sturm's English class at Georgia Institute of Technology. Now, to dive into the intriguing life of comic book writer, poet, and visionary, Tom Veitch. Tom Veitch was born on September 26, 1941 in Bellows Falls, Vermont, a small village located within the town of Rockingham. Tom grew up with five other wildly creative siblings. Each one took up drawing from an early age, contributing to Tom's childhood publishing endeavors, where he produced a weekly Mimeo newspaper and numerous hand-drawn comic book titles. But as the eldest, it was luckily his father that Tom looked up to while growing up. We all inherited artistic talent from our father, Bob Veitch. He was an excellent illustrator in his youth. But after rejecting an invitation to work for Disney's animation studio, Tom's father moved to Vermont and began working for Robertson Paper Company. My impression is that the economic depression made him reach for a secure niche, even if it meant putting his art aside. So, with the noblest of intentions, Tom's father settled and raised his family, a creative mind, in a not-so-creative town. Rick Veitch, Tom's younger brother and well-known comic book artist and writer, described the Veitch situation best. My environment was such that I was bombarded by a constant reinforcement that art was a dead end, that creativity was kind of suspicious. I grew up in a dying mill town and my dad was a very good artist, a very creative person. He got into the situation where he had to work a regular job in a factory his whole life in order to bring up six kids. However, Tom Veitch looked to escape the societal cage that trapped his father and hoped to make a name for himself as a writer. This meant moving to the post-war literary and artistic capital of the world, the hub for every major social movement from the 1950s onward, the city that never sleeps, New York City. It was 1959 when Veitch first moved to New York to attend Columbia College. The literary setting in the city was booming. Writers such as John Ashbery, Barbara Guest, Kenneth Koch, Frank O'Hara, and James Schuyler had set the stage throughout the 1950s as part of the first generation of New York school poets. Their works were characterized by explicit sexual expressions and shared social interactions, as well as making the ordinary and everyday into the extraordinary and unfamiliar. By the time Veitch had entered the scene, though, a second generation of poets had begun gathering, taking the ideas of the first generation and giving them a more rugged and countercultural flair. They took inspiration from pop art and rock music, art styles that were growing in popularity. This generation included Ted Berrigan, Alice Notley, Joe Brainard, Ron Padgett, Dick Gallup, Tom Clark, Lewis Warsh, and many more. During his studies at Columbia, Tom Veitch was introduced to the rest of the New York School when his friend, Lorenz Gude, showed Ted Berrigan the novel Veitch had just finished. He and Berrigan hit it off from the start. For some reason, Ted liked my writing. The first thing he saw by me was a first-person novel called The Transfigured. He loved it, and we immediately became friends. In fact, I was welcomed into the Tulsa Circle. The Tulsa Circle is a phrase referring to the subgroup of second-generation New York school poets that mostly came from Tulsa, Oklahoma, almost like the inner rings of the group. Even so, Veitch did not immediately start writing for the New York school. In fact, following an existential crisis that plunged him into depression and drugs, Veitch dropped out of college and left New York behind. By 1962, Veitch was back in Vermont, penniless, without a degree, and his novel unpublished. He got a job as a mechanic. So, was that it? Was his dream to become a writer over? Did he have to give up his creative talents for a steady yet dual job as his father had done before him? Well, obviously not. Upon an invitation by Ted Berrigan, Veitch returned to New York in 1963. He began to write and collaborate with the New York School in earnest, working out of the back room of Bob Wilson's bookstore and getting his first work published by Berrigan, a work called Literary Days. Literary Days is the first of a series of pamphlets that were edited and published by Ted Berrigan's C Press in 1964. It combines excerpts from Tom Veitch's What's, a Psychic Novel, and his sections of a collaboration done with Berrigan called Magmo's End. The cover and illustrations were done by Joe Brainard. Interestingly, Literary Days continuously switches characters, settings, and circumstances, yet the themes of everyday life, sexuality, and social interactions can be found throughout, such as a couple getting some food after hours of intimacy, a boy undergoing a ceremony to become a man, and a husband returning home to his wife and child after spending 10 years in prison. Even just a chair that folds. Yet, at the same time, these familiar moments are framed by various strange and unconventional situations or characters. In this way, Literary Days embodies the culture that had formed in New York poetry at the time, demonstrating just how immersed Veitch had become in the New York School and its ideals. So, it is 1965, and Veitch is dominating the New York literary scene. He is writing and getting published by various magazines and mimeos, including Ed Sanders' Fuck You, Peter Sheldahl's Mother, and John Ashbery's Art and Literature. He's getting noticed by notable writers like William S. Burroughs and Allen Ginsberg, and he is partying with all kinds of interesting people, having a grand time. It was a great wild time for a couple years. All the poetry scene sort of merged, and poets and artists partied together. Ted would say, "Let's go see Andy," and we would go uptown to Andy Warhol's factory and hang out with those people. That kind of thing. Everything was going great in the Big Apple. So, what does he do next? Well, of all things, become a monk. From 1965 to late 1967, Veitch was a cloistered Benedictine monk in Weston, Vermont. During that time, he studied Jungian philosophy and began to develop a lasting fascination with the deep psyche. While Carl G. Jung had already been his chief mentor from as early as 1963, he really delved deeply into Jung's teachings while at the monastery. This was also when he befriended Elias, a former Trappist monk and the subject of Veitch's 2016 book, The Visions of Elias. According to Veitch, his sudden decision to become a monk was not a reaction to the literary scene. Instead, it was motivated by deep and profound experiences that are paralleled by Elias' own life as described in Veitch's recent book. My experiences weren't as intense as his, perhaps, but they were real enough and they came from inside. Certainly they were powerful enough to make me rejoin the Catholic Church and enter a monastery. And that period spent in the monastery would influence Veitch's writing from then on. After his time spent as a monk, Veitch returned to the big city again. But not New York. No. This time, he moved to San Francisco. Hot town, summer in the city. Back of my neck getting dirty and gritty. Bend down, isn't it a pity? Doesn't seem to be a shadow in the city. All around, people looking half dead. Walking on the sidewalk harder than a match here. Veitch lived in a house on Potrero Hill with other poets and musicians. His life quickly accelerated as he published various avant-garde novels, wrote two screenplays, and even edited his own magazine. The novels he wrote include Eat This, The Luis Armed Story, and Antlers in the Treetops, a cooperation with Ron Padgett. In 1973, Veitch received the Big Table Award for Poetry for his book Death College and Other Poems. And on top of all that, Veitch was simultaneously experimenting with underground comics, working with artist Greg Irons on two issues of Deviant Slice and other works. He also met his wife, Martha Veitch, during this incredible time period. Meanwhile, many New York school poets began moving to nearby Bolinas, California. Veitch referred to themselves at this time as one big happy cultural family. One of Veitch's great accomplishments was writing, editing, and publishing his own magazine called Tom Veitch Magazine. It ran four issues from 1970 to 1972, each one sent to various friends and fellow writers of the New York School for free. Issue 1 consisted of poetry only. Issue 2 combined poetry and prose, including four poems that, keeping true to the New York School spirit, Veitch and Ron Padgett had worked together to write. For issue 3, Veitch published a set of three collaborations between himself and a different writer for each one. The collaborators were Tom Clark, Lewis McAdams, and Andre Codrescu. The issue was fully prose. The final issue of Tom Veitch Magazine included a continuation of the Veitch-Codrescu work from the previous issue, some early underground comics work by Veitch and Greg Irons, and a full comic book story called Crazy Mouse that was scripted by Tom Veitch and drawn by his younger brother, Rick Veitch. Tom Veitch Magazine shows a clear progression in Veitch's style of writing as he switches from a New York school poet into more of an underground comics writer. As the transition occurs, though, the themes of sexuality and social interactions that emerge from the New York school remain prevalent in his writing. Veitch adds to those themes a little Jungian perspective and a focus on dreams and the deep psyche, which he picked up from his time at the monastery. He also puts a bit of counterculture rebelliousness and revolution in the magazine to match the times. Tom Veitch Magazine was truly a unique mixture of styles depicting the various influences affecting Veitch during the early 1970s and beyond. While Veitch was enjoying his time participating with the New York School and the undergrounds, trouble was stirring in the U.S. Supreme Court. In 1973, a Supreme Court case decision forever changed the nature of published media and its accessibility to the public. The case was Miller versus California, and it played a critical role in collapsing the underground comics market, destroying the livelihoods of many writers. In a 5-4 decision, the court ruled that obscene materials do not enjoy First Amendment rights, and it redefined the word obscenity, changing it from that of utterly without socially redeeming value to that which lacks serious literary, artistic, political, or scientific value. By giving a stricter definition to obscenity, the Supreme Court deemed local courts capable of handling obscenity trials on their own. This led to a swift crackdown on most adult bookstores, eventually extinguishing the golden age of underground comics. But rather than go down with the ship, Veitch joined mainstream comics like Marvel and DC, and from there, it was a steady progression onwards and upwards. The Nazz was a 4-issue comic published in 1990 with art by Brian Talbot. The story follows an American man as he journeys to the East seeking enlightenment and power. He is granted amazing gifts which eventually develop into the power to alter reality itself. Upon returning to America, however, he falls into an egotistical pit of self-indulgence and pride. In the end, it is his overinflated ego that leads to his own death at the hands of his ex-lover. Although Veitch had left behind underground comics, the Nazz still contains very mature themes and images that show the influence underground comics had on Veitch. His ability to create morally ambiguous protagonists was incredible, especially since perfectly righteous superheroes dominated the comic industry at the time. I've always thought that the dark side of human behavior should be looked at without blinkers. That is the only way we are ever going to deal with it. The sexual openness in The Nazz is also reminiscent of Veitch's work with the New York School. and his theme of innate power deep within normal people refers to Carl Jung's philosophy. Another notable theme that has been developing throughout Veitch's work since the 1960s is the sexual, emotional, and physical mistreatment of women, which is so relevant today. When asked whether he meant to bring awareness to issues of rape and sex trafficking through his various writings throughout the decades, Veitch responded, "I was never conscious of publishing a message about sexuality, but the stories that took form in me might have been expressing a dream message from the mind, maybe from the body itself." So, be sure to check out The Naz, another amazing series created by our very own Tom Veitch. So how did Tom Veitch go from creating underground comics to working on Star Wars and other mainstream comics? Well, Veitch's brother, Rick, was part of the first graduating class of the Kubert School of Cartoon and Graphic Art. While he was studying there, Tom would visit him. Joe Kubert, the founder of the school, knew about Tom Veitch from his work in underground comics. Through Kubert, Veitch got connected to DC Comics, writing Sergeant Rock issue 356. From there, Veitch worked simultaneously for Marvel's Epic imprint and DC Comics as a freelancer. For Epic, he wrote The Light and Darkness War, an intriguing story about a Vietnam War veteran who rejoins his dead comrades in the afterlife where they are forced to fight in a 10,000-year war. For DC, Veitch wrote various comic series such as Clash, My Name is Chaos, Animal Man, issues 33 through 50, and The Naz. Through these comics, he explored the theme of awakening to natural Superman consciousness, which is a very Jungian concept. In the early 90s, Veitch was contracted to write for Star Wars along with Cam Kennedy. The two had sent George Lucas their collaboration, The Light and Darkness War. He liked it so much that he hired them to write Star Wars Dark Empire, a comic that takes place right after the events of Return of the Jedi. Veitch also conceived and wrote The Tales of the Jedi, along with Kevin J. Anderson. With all the ideas and work he put into writing these comics, Veitch could be considered the father of the Star Wars extended universe. To this day, the popularity of the Star Wars franchise and Veitch's incredibly creative storylines have ensured that Veitch will forever be remembered in the hearts of Star Wars comic fans everywhere. Tom Veitch currently resides in Vermont with his wife Martha. He continues to write creative and eye-opening works, like most recently, Visions of Elias. A new book about his time while working on Star Wars will soon be published, and the world will wait with bated breath until we hear from Veitch again. Well, I would like to hold my little hand. I will well run with, I will well cry with. I would like to hold my little hand. I will well run with, I will well cry. Send me on my way. Send me on my way. Send me on my way.
stretch out my hand. Oh, me say, oh, me tell you to run.
On my way, on my way,
my buddy say, my buddy on. Oh.